Hey everybody, it's our second episode of the Basics of Turkey Hunting with NWTF. Travis Sumner here. Good to see everybody again tonight. This is our second episode. Last week we had a really great episode of learning turkey basics, the basics for the new hunter. You know, we talked about the different species of turkeys and we spoke with some wildlife officers to talk about the basic rules and regs and the tags that you need. We looked at where you could find these turkeys to hunt. And then we talked about other resources to get you started and to help you learn how to turkey hunt. This entire series for now, let's see, we started, it's going to be 6 weeks, is all about teaching you the basics to turkey hunting basics, turkey 101. So tonight, guys and gals, if you're out there, we want to talk a little bit about gear. Tonight is all about gear, basic gear, the basics that you need. Think about this. Turkey hunters are a lot like fishermen. We all need all the gear we can get to make put things in our odds, particularly when it comes to turkeys. And we're going to talk about some different things that you would need to the basic needs you would need to get started. We're not talking about going out and buying every turkey call. We're not going out and talking about all the gear that's available, but the basic needs. And this is important. When it comes to turkey hunting, it's all about calls. It's all about blinds, decoys, all the things that you need. And that's going to get you started because you start thinking about, hey, I'm on a turkey hunt. Well, what do I need? What's the gear I need? And we're going to have really, in just a little bit, we've got two great guests coming on with two of our great partners from Nomad and Mossy Oak. And I'll introduce those a little bit later. But guys, it's all about the gear, learning what are the basic things you can get started with. And then as you progress through your turkey hunting experience and the more you get into turkey hunting, then you start talking about, hey, I might need to get this or I need that. But it's all about the basic gear when it comes to camo, clothing. And hey, every year, one of the cool things is to see all the new stuff that comes out. And gear has changed over the years. It continues to grow when it comes to what you're going to wear in the field. It's all about being comfortable because the gear you wear, it's about patience. And I'm telling you, it's all about gear. If my wife were sitting here right now, she would probably say, yeah, he's about gear, because if it doesn't get sent to him to use, he's out there trying to find the next new thing. And we just had somebody popped up that talked about being a gear junkie. But tonight, we want to talk about basic gear, basic things you need so you can go out there and chase those gobblers this spring. So what we want to do first is we always talk about the turkey vest. And the turkey vest is probably the first thing that pops up. Hey, I need a turkey vest. And I remember my first turkey vest, wasn't a whole lot to it, but turkey vests have evolved and changed over the years. And your turkey vest, I like to look at it as your tackle box. If you're a fisherman, it's your you take a tackle box fishing and you got all kinds of things in there to attract and catch fish. Same thing with a turkey vest. It's all about having those calls or things to make you comfortable and get you out there. So we've got a video we want to run for you about what's in your turkey vest.
Hey, I'm Travis Sumner with the National Wild Turkey Federation. For the turkey hunter, the turkey vest is much like a fisherman's tackle box. You carry everything in there to put the odds in your favor. For a turkey hunter, his vest is his lifeline while he's out there in the field. Let's look at some things for the basic turkey hunter is a must to have in your turkey vest. You know, first and foremost is your calls. Whether it's your slate calls, your box calls, being versatile, having different calls to use out there for that wily turkey. He may be answering a box one day, but the next day you may need to go to a slate call. Using different strikers will help you sound like different turkeys on one slate call. Locator calls, a must, whether it's your owl call down to your crow call. Having something to locate a turkey first before you make your setups, always important. Sometimes it gets to the point where they might be listening to a lot of owls and a lot of crows. Then you switch to maybe a peacock or a woodpecker call, or even a goose call would be a good locator call to have in your vest. Make sure you have plenty of mask and gloves. The mask is always important. I've been known to leave my mask somewhere in the woods. Always having two in your vest is a good thing, because you turn around on your next setup and you're looking for a mask and it's not there, but at least you got a backup. Same thing goes for gloves. I like to carry two pair of gloves in my vest. This is probably the best thing out there, is a thermocell. Having that thermocell, I can always put it beside me or strap it to my vest. Keep those bugs away. You don't want to be moving around swatting mosquitoes when that gobbler shows up. Optics, you know, having a good set of binoculars, of course, you know, they may be in my vest at times, but I'm wearing those. That way I've got a good way to pick up turkeys in the woods or in a field. Rangefinder, you know, for the beginner hunter, determining range is always a problem. So if you've got that rangefinder, you can get out there and range a tree, range a stump. You know exactly when that turkey's in range so you can make that killing shot. Of course, you always want to have your tags with you. Always carry them in a plastic bag in case they get wet. Ammunition, always have your ammunition with you. And then as you move along, some other things that I carry, getting a little bit more advanced, I like to have a wing. I can mimic that turkey flying down out of a tree, scratching the leaves, or even a good old-fashioned turkey fight out there. Something to carry that old gobbler out of the woods with. I've made a tote out of an old antler, and that's always easy to carry him out with. Carrying extra pegs for my vest, you know, to hold up my decoys while I'm out there, because those seem to take missing on a given basis. You know, I always carry a few extras of those. Another call that I like to carry, getting a little bit more advanced, is a tube call. It's a change of pace where you're using your box calls, your slate calls, your mouth calls, but having that old tube call out there to locate with and even gobble on it is a great thing to have. Also, having a good set of pruning shears. You never know when you may have to do a makeshift blind or cut some limbs down out of your way to be able to see. Or if you've got a new hunter, you want nothing to constrict their eyesight to see that gobbler. But good pruning shears are always a must. And, you know, you're out there calling turkeys, but you never know when the call may hit you. And always have this ready to go just in case. But as I said, a turkey hunter, the turkey vest is much like the tackle box. Always have your turkey vest ready and stocked up with the things you need so you'll have success in the spring woods.
There you go, guys. Talking about a little bit of stuff that goes in that turkey vest. And hey, I mentioned earlier, we have two guests with us tonight that are with our great partners, and they're partners with NWTF. They help us with a lot, particularly with our mentor programs and everything that we do. It's always great having great partners. So I'd like to introduce our two guests tonight, from Mossy Oak, Norman Sneed, and from Nomad, Devin Sweeney.
Hey, Travis.
Norman and Devin, how y'all tonight?
Pretty good. How you doing?
Good.
Doing great. Hey, getting all geared up. Turkey season's right around the corner, unless you're in South Florida tonight.
Not here.
Awesome. Hey, guys, I appreciate you coming on tonight. And as I mentioned earlier, Mossy Oak and Nomad are great partners to the National Wild Turkey Federation. You do a whole lot for us partnering together. I think we're all in the business about preserving our hunting heritage and conservation from all sides of the fence. Creating new hunters is a big part of making sure our conservation and our heritage continues on. Hey, you know, I wanted to, you know, I was talking about gear tonight, and both of you work for two companies that are all about gear, and turkey gear is important this time of year at Mossy Oak and particularly at Nomad in the springtime. So I've got a question I'm going to ask both of you. I'm going to start with Devin. So we're talking about the first time hunter, and we're looking at basic needs. What would you tell me if I was a first time hunter? What are the basics, Devin, that I would need start out with?
I'd say, you know, something that you probably don't already have in your house would definitely be a turkey vest. I mean, that's like number one thing you're gonna have to grab. I know you guys just hit on it, is a turkey vest. Like you said, something to carry all your stuff, a pad. Outside of that, you're gonna need, you know, camo is important here, you know, because the way that a turkey sees and movement. So nice pair of pants, nice shirt, gloves, face mask, and a hat. That gets you going outside of a call. You know, one box call can get you rocking. So I think those are kind of like the shortest of the short list right there.
That's great. And that's, you know, that's the short list. And, you know, it, somebody popped up on there about being a new gear junkie. Anytime anything new comes out, everybody's about, hey, I need that. I need this. I need this new call. I need this new vest. And I notice each year we talk about turkey vests. Each year a new vest comes out. You know, you guys at Nomad got a new vest out this year. And, you know, of course, at Mossy Oak, we see the different vests come out. So, Norman, I got a question for you. Now, you know, Mossy Oak, the beginnings, Toxie, avid turkey hunter, the whole family, all you guys are. And, you know, Toxie developed Mossy Oak for turkey hunting in the beginning. Is that right?
Absolutely. To quote him, you know, find a better way to hide from the critters. And in this case, it was the turkeys.
And it was the turkey. So that's what makes this so neat. So Norman, you know, Mossy Oak is works hand in foot with Nomad. I know that Nomad carries a lot of great Mossy Oak camo. Matter of fact, I'm sporting the new Shadow Leaf tonight. And I'm excited to get out there. It's great to see the old patterns come back, but of course the new patterns are good and Bottomland seems to be a favorite. But from your side, Norman, you know, when, if I asked you, and I know Devin hit on it, there's all kinds of gear that people need to get started with, pants, gloves, masks, a vest. When it comes to a turkey hunting vest, and if it was a first time hunter, where would you tell them to start looking? Or what, well, to choose from?
Right. You know, it all depends on how big of a bite they want to take right out of the gate. You know, Devin hit the nail on the head on talking about, you know, just your basics to do that. And, you know, you can find a really good turkey vest at a lot of retailers around there or e-commerce sites from our partners, you know, Walmart. You know, I hate to pull out one specific one, but, you know, there's a lot of Walmarts out there that if that particular one carries, you know, the hunting section in there, you can pretty well be outfitted. What Devin was talking about, head to toe and some inexpensive calls as well. You know, it's when I was watching you do the piece on turkey vests, I couldn't help but shake my head because every year my turkey vest seems like it gets heavier and heavier with all the things in there, about like a tackle box. Everybody dreams that they're going to have that lure to catch the fish that nobody else has. And it's the same thing with turkey hunting. Everybody's hoping they got that one call that one day that, you know, is going to drive them crazy that nobody else has. So you carry a lot of it.
Absolutely. And, you know, I've had, be on a hunt or be somewhere and somebody will pick up my vest and say, my goodness, what have you got in there? Have you got a huge weight or something? And I'm like, you just don't want to know what all's in there.
Yeah, absolutely. I go through periods where I say, man, I got to take some of this out of here, but I can't eliminate anything.
That's right. That's right. Hey, Devin, let me ask you a question. I know, you know, with the Nomad clothing, I know Mossy Oak offers the same thing. When you guys are looking, you know, and a lot of times people are going to ask a question, you know, I buy camo. They may not be familiar. How long is normally, I know what you guys are making, and Norman, particularly with what is it, the online store, Mossy Oak, how long does camo, how do you take care of your camo to make it last for you, to keep it from fading? Because I know I've been asked that question before, particularly with these first-time folks.
Yeah, and the good news is like technology's come a long way. So, you know, back when Mossy Oak started and everybody started, a lot of stuff was on cotton. And I don't bore anybody with the printing process, but essentially every time you wash that, you're losing it. So that's where you see a lot of that camo that's out there that's really white looking or washed out. And so everything that we're using now at Nomad is using, you know, a different process on the polyester and the performance fabrics. So as long as you don't leave that out in the sun like a couple days in a row, it's going to look, the camo itself is going to look brand new almost for the life of the garment until it starts to really come apart. So that's the good news about it, is, you know, the camo is going to look as good as the day you bought it. Everybody always recommends, you know, using non-UV brightener wash and scent free. It doesn't really matter on the turkey, but just using the purest detergent that you can get allows all the garments to continue to work really well. Like turkey hunting's in the spring, you want something to dry fast and wick, you know, moisture in your sweat. So not using synthetic dryer sheets and using really clean detergent will help keep that garment working good. But the camo is going to look really good if you're buying something in the, you know, performance fabric realm.
Here's a question. So would you recommend any of this lightweight polyester material they offer in camo now? Either one of you guys, Norman or Devin, you know, I know that's out there. So would you recommend that?
That's all I hunt in. I
think that's, you know, what the trend has gone to, just for the performance, because depending on where you're at and, you know, the weather rolls in, you know, you could start out in the morning, you know, and it'd be cool. I'll be honest with you. I've been some of the coldest I think I've ever been hunting is early turkey hunts because I'm not ready for it, you know, and that's when the layering comes in with a quarter zip or a hoodie or a little fleece jacket or even a vest, you know, that you can take off and put in your bag on your turkey vest. You know, to Devin's point, I don't think there's, you know, anything more indispensable than your turkey vest, you know, to be able to carry all your gear. You know, it doesn't matter how much you stack in there, you know, a good vest is a really good investment. Absolutely. But like everybody on this screen, you know, it's, you kind of evolve over time. And I don't think there's really been a time when there's more good gear out there, good clothing, good camouflage, good ammo, good guns, decoys, everything. You know, we're living in a great time for turkey hunting.
Absolutely. Devin, did you have one of the new vests there? I mean, you know, because vests seem to be a key thing because it holds all your gear. And, you know, we've talked about that, but, you know, Norman, if you're like me, Devin, if you're like me, the longer you can sit and the more comfortable you had, everybody will ask, well, what kind of seat pads that thing got on the back of it? So if you want to show, is that the killing time vest?
No, this one, since we wanted to talk about new turkey hunters.
Awesome. This is great.
This is the Pursuit Vest, which ties into the whole Pursuit series that we're doing. And basically, like, the killing time for folks that are watching, you know, we took Hart and Tussie and Pete and a bunch of other people that have, you know, basically have gone through the gambit, and they, everything they wanted in a turkey vest, we built the killing time. And then we did the exact opposite with the Pursuit. It was basically like, if you just have a couple, if you're just going to run out really quick, what's the basic stuff you need to go hunting? And we built the Pursuit vest to carry that, you know, carry a friction call, carry a box call, carry a mouth call. And so that's what this is. And so basically, like, you nailed it. I mean, the number one key is going to be a pad to a turkey vest, right? So this is what makes or breaks most turkey vests in people's minds. Are the reason you're going to carry it is, you know, stay comfortable. A lot of times you might end up sitting a lot longer than you want, having something that's, you know, waterproof, pretty durable on the bottom, and then a nice thick pad. So whether you're sitting on a rock or a root, that's an important feature. And then the rest of it is just carrying the gear. This one, we've got a little backpack in the back here. Like Norman said, you can throw a hoodie in there. I think almost everybody has that same story. Like, the coldest I've ever been is in turkey season, right? Either you're not for it, but, you know, you can throw a jacket in here, water bottle, toilet paper, wet wipes, depending on what you want to do. And then basically just, it's just set up to just carry your stuff, right? So, like on here, you got like pruners. You know, and then it's got opportunity here to carry your shells for, you know, backup shots and things like that. And then you can put a rangefinder in there, and then it just keeps everything accessible for you, right? So that's the whole reason you're doing this, is not a lot of movement when you're turkey hunting. So you've got my friction call here over on the other side. We've got a box call, and something that I think is as vital as anything, especially for the places I hunt, is a thermocell. So,
absolutely,
you don't know that thermocells, it keeps you from swatting mosquitoes, getting ate up all the time. So, to me, that's something I'd hardly ever turkey hunt without, is that thermocell right there. And then, like I said, so this keeps all those calls nice and easy. So, this is the new Pursuit vest from us. And the great thing about it is it's lightweight. You can throw everything in there. It's a little bit more than enough, you know, for gun hunting. Carry water bottles on your hip too, and then it is adjustable. So like even after turkey season's over with, you can just unclip the top part and wear it as a fanny pack if you're, you know, checking trail cameras or just walking through the woods and scouting.
That's cool. Hey, one of the things, Norman, I wanted to throw your way, you know, Devin, that's great because I know from my side and what my job, part of my job is at NWTF with our mentor and our Learn to Hunt programs, and we're taking people out for the first time, particularly young adults, college students. And, you know, I'm wearing Mossy Oak gear and Nomad gear with my affiliation with you guys, and they'll look at it and they're going, hey, where can I find that? And that's, you know, that's been a great, you know, to be able to show them, they're asking you about the stuff. But Norman, you know, Mossy Oak has a tremendous group of partners. And, you know, for a first time hunter, a question's always come up about blinds, the turkey blinds that are out there now. You know, and I know that Mossy Oak's affiliated with a lot of folks when it comes to blinds, the little low rider chairs, you know, that sit to the ground, which I call a redneck beach chair. Yep. Tell us a little bit. I mean, give us a little bit insight on those blinds and chairs and what you think from that standpoint.
Absolutely. You know, here again, it's we're very fortunate that we have, you know, a lot of good partners in those categories, all the categories that we're talking about tonight. And, you know, blinds play a big part in turkey hunting. You know, it all depends on your experience, where you're going, how many folks that you have there, where you're trying to hide, you know, and you look at the blinds also in the different sizes, you know, just like Devin showing that vest, you know, that's a little bit less expensive vest, doesn't have all the features that the more expensive vest does. It's the same way with blinds. You know, people that we partner with that, you know, Alps, Primos, Rhino, goodness, they're a Bog, Ameristep, you know, every one of these folks have different blinds in different patterns, Mossy Oak patterns, that you can kind of tailor to how many people you're trying to hide and how much you want to spend.
Absolutely. Now I'm going to direct this and you may both have, you know, the other thing that comes to mind when you're talking about gear is, you know, is calls. And we got a segment down the road talking about calls, but when we're talking about gear, you know, the Thermacell, Jason Lepardus, my buddy up there, and with NWTF Thermacell is like, you know, when that came out, that was the best thing since sliced bread. But what about decoys, guys? I mean, when you start talking about decoys, you know, that's another thing. Is that part of your arsenal, or how important, you know, you think decoys are for that first time, and where to find those?
Yeah. I mean, I think, the key to me, especially starting off when I was younger, was, getting something that was somewhat compactable and easier to carry. I mean, it gets pretty tough, especially if you're going to be hunting public or someplace that you got to cover a lot of dirt. Actually having a decoy that you're willing to carry that whole way is important. So like right now I'm using the Avian X ones. You know, they shrink down pretty good by letting air out. They stay light and you can easily put them in the back of a turkey vest, or you can carry an additional bag. So that's what I'm running right now. You know, and I know there's a lot of options out there at various price points, but
right.
I think right. that's about that's what I'd be getting if I could.
And in Norman, Avian's a part of, that's one of our Mossy Oak partners, correct?
Right. Absolutely. You know, here again, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but you know, the options that are out there for the hunters, I don't ever remember having the quality, not only on the versatility, you know, it doesn't matter what you want to spend. You can spend as much as you want. And even the less expensive ones, you know, compared to what was out there when I started and got serious with it, is night and day. You know, it's amazing. Absolutely. You know, Avian X, you know, Primos, goodness, there's a lot of folks out there, Flextone, that make a good decoy, you know, and they not only look good, but they vary in price. And, you know, I speaking to what you asked earlier about it, you know, it nearly depends on where I'm at, you know, if I'm using one or not. I always have one with me with the option to use them, but you know, there are times that I feel like I don't need to use one, or, you know, don't have time to put one up and get where I need to do. But, you know, when I started hunting, I looked at decoys, as Devin said, it depends on how much ground you're having to try to cover. You know, also you got to be careful if you're hunting private land, you know, public land with decoys. But, you know, it's a good way to let those turkeys concentrate on something else instead of you when they're coming in with a decoy. So, you know, there's a lot of good options out there.
Yeah. And a good price point option is, like, if you can get a hold of one, or it's just a turkey fan itself, you know? So,
yep.
Like, you know, you saw in the video carrying a wing, a lot of people carry a fan, yep. You know, and, you know, so that's a really easy, lightweight way to get started. They make some pretty different, you know, they're real ones, obviously, and then they make some, you know, realistic versions too, but that's a pretty cheap and easy way to get started.
Right. I can see this question, guys. I'm going to ask Norman, and then I'm going to ask you, Devin, because this would come up. If you had to pick in the decoy department, would it be a hen or a gobbler, Norman?
Oh, gosh. You know,
a jake.
When I started, and for really and truly, I always try to have a hen decoy. I use, if possible, 2 to 3 if I'm going to use decoys. I think the general consensus right now kind of seems to be maybe a jake. But me personally, I think if I just had one, I would be hard pressed not to put a hen out there.
Okay. Devin, how about you?
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, the whole use them, when not to use them, what to use. I've always got, a jake and a hen with me, it seems like. Mm-hmm. I probably would tend to lean with, like, Norman. Like, I mean, you're most of the time you're making hen calls, so it makes the most sense in my mind to have a hen out in front of you, because it just matches everything that's going on. Right. So if I'm going to get one out real quick, I'll get that hen out real quick. Because that's what, you know, the whole game is, you know, you're trying to get them to do something they're not used to doing that's coming.
That's
in.
Right.
Get the hen out there and letting them see it and hear it, I think it helps a little bit. So that's probably what I would do, is if I could only put one out, it'd probably be the hen.
Cool. Hey, you know, kind of wrapping things up here. So with these new hunters, and I know both of you mentioned that, and it's a question directed to both of you, kind of to fill out both your answers. So if you were hunting on a budget, and Norman, I know you mentioned Walmart, Academy's another one that's out there. If you were hunting on a budget, where would be a great place to go find these? And I know we can go to Nomad, and, you know, every time you see there's a 20% off or a 10% off discount, where would you go to find, if you were hunting on a budget, where's the best place to start out to get this stuff that you need?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I'm going to tell you to go to Nomad.com. But, Pete's always running some deals and stuff. I can just go back to when I started, right? So when I first got going, there was, like, you know, I didn't even have a local Walmart. We didn't really have a lot near me. So Sportsman's Guide was one of the ways that I got going on some lower price gear and stuff like that. And that was back in catalog days. But, you can get it just about anywhere. Sportsman's Guide, Walmart, obviously all the big retailers, like, you know, Sportsman's Warehouse and Bass Pro Shops and Cabela's. There's price point ranges everywhere now. And, like, I would just always say, always tell everybody, hey, look, I know that when you're getting going, like, this stuff's not expensive anyways. Like, turkey vest I showed you on our lower price point, but it's like $100. But you can go and you can buy a pair of pants for $30. But, you know, you can get something a lot nicer for like $50, right? So, like, it's just an extra $20 if you're looking in that range. So just always caution everybody, you know, sometimes just buying the cheapest thing to give it a whirl isn't the best thing. You know, if you think you're going more than once, I would say, hey, spend a little bit more money.
Norman, what's your thought?
I'm kind of in line with Devin. You know, it seems like a lot of brands that are out there, you know, this pandemic that we went through last year that basically started in turkey season. You know, I think a lot of the dealers and brands as well are in tune with this, and you can, you know, get some pretty good deals on some things straight from them. And I do feel like to some instance, I know exactly what you mean by a starting hunter. You kind of grow into it, but you know, you more or less get what you pay for. And but if you're just starting out, you know, you don't want to sink a lot of money into that. You know, the Mossy Oak store in West Point, mossyoak.com, you know, they've got a lot of good items from different prices and from different partners as well. So you have the whole gamut there. You know, so again, we're living in an age that we're all kind of blessed. I think the biggest problem you're going to have is, you know, finding your size in what you want. Mm-hmm. Right now, because there's a lot more turkey hunters than there were a year ago based on what happened last year. And I hope that continues. But, you know, that's one issue that you got to deal with. So the sooner you get after it and get what you need, get your hands on it, buy it.
Absolutely. And you're right. We saw this last year with the pandemic, an increase in across just about everybody. Everybody wanted to get out and turkey hunt when this thing hit, and it took off. And, you know, for both of you guys and the businesses that you're in, that's a good thing. And, you know, we saw people continuously wanting to hunt, hunting license sales shot up. And hopefully that'll happen again this year. And, you know, it's just around the corner. Any final thoughts from you guys?
Yeah, just get out there and enjoy it. If you're thinking about it and you haven't tried it, the great thing about NWTF and the convention and turkey hunters in general is everybody likes talking about turkey hunting. Everybody usually will carry you. I mean, it's, you know, like the youth seasons are out there that are available. They get first crack at it most of the time. A lot of people, as they get older and turkey hunting experience, most of them just end up carrying people and don't even really hunt themselves. So, like, if you think about it or you're interested, call somebody, you know, email us. I mean, you know, I got Jason Hart. He's never tried to go on a turkey hunt with anybody. So I'll volunteer him to go with some people. But yeah, get out there and try it. I'm sure you'll enjoy it. I mean, it's really fun. So
I'm going to have to agree with him. You know, it's you hit the nail on the head. There's a lot more people out there. Licenses sold, people, you know, it's an opportunity. Pandemic was a double-edged sword. You know, you do have the opportunity to spend time with your family, friends, you know, out in the woods. You don't have to worry about social distancing, you know, and it's a wonderful thing to do, to take somebody young or old who's never hunted turkeys. You know, the one thing about that is, though, as we all know, it's very addictive. So you may be having to take him to some places that maybe he can't go by himself.
Absolutely. Well, guys, I certainly appreciate you guys joining us tonight. Thank you for what you do for the National Wild Turkey Federation. Devin, Norman, man, good luck this spring. I hope y'all enjoy it and get after them.
Yep. Thanks,
y'all. Thank you, guys.
Thanks for what you guys do.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much. Wow. Some great information there on finding gear that you need from two of our great partners at Nomad and at Mossy Oak. Hey guys, you know, one of the other things that you kind of got to think about, we've talked about the gear you need, the vest, all this other. Let's talk a little bit about maybe what you want to take from a firearm standpoint. You know, that's always important. Firearms are very, very important. And selecting the correct firearm to fit you is a very important part of your gear or the things that you need to get out there before you turkey hunt. Everybody asks me, hey, what do you think I need from a firearm standpoint? What gauge do I need to start with? Find something that fits you the best. You know, if it's, and typically this is a shotgun starting out. You know, there's various gauges now with the ammunition that another one of our great partners, Federal Ammunition, has. That goes anywhere from a 410 shotgun, 20 gauge, 12 gauge with the TSS and all the federal lines that are out there. And of course, you know, picking the right shotgun is always important. You got to select one that fits best for you. Another great partner that's a part of NWTF in our mentoring program is TriStar. TriStar has a great selection of shotguns and that you could use out there. So once you've selected what gauge fits you best, the correct ammunition, let's talk about patterning. And you got to pattern your shotgun and going out, first of all, and practicing. Don't practice, you know, right out of the gate. Start with a bird load or a low, like an 8 shot or a 7.5. Set you up some targets at about 20 yards. Optimum range for a wild turkey to make a clean kill or a clean harvest is about 30 to 35 yards. Why is that so? Let's talk a little bit on the turkey choke side. Turkey chokes are constricted. And the reason that they do that is because the target that you're shooting at, and I'm going to show you, is the turkey's head. We don't shoot into the body. It's the head, so it's a small area. So having a tight choke is what you want. If you look at the target there, you see where your aiming point would be. When you shoot, you're aiming for the turkey's neck and head. It's the old saying where the red meets the black, the wattles meet the black on the neck is what you're aiming for. So that's where your aiming point is. The turkey chokes that are out there today that you can go and purchase are going to have a hold a really tight pattern. So it's the closer the bird gets to you, the tighter the pattern. It's almost like throwing a softball, and you're more likely to miss. Everybody talks about being close. It's not always true. I like to see that turkey at optimum range where I know my pattern's spread out, and that's why I go and practice at about 35 yards, 30 yards. You know, and the closer it gets, things get a little bit more tricky. You think, oh, that's an easy shot. Well, it's not because your pattern's so tight. So what you're going to do is you're going to select the shotgun. You're going to look at a variety of chokes if you need, if starting out. And most of these turkey guns, I know TriStar is one of those that comes out with a full, an extra full, an improved, and a modified. That full or extra full choke that comes with the shotgun when you purchase it, hey, it'll do the job. As you get advanced, then you start looking into the turkey chokes that you might want to use. You might want to use that has a lot tighter and it's going to hold your pattern a lot longer. So get out there and practice. You shoot at these different ranges, shoot with different loads. The loads that you might be looking at are sixes. They may be fives, maybe fours. You know, back when I first started out turkey hunting, it was number fours. So you've got to shoot these several times and find out what holds a good pattern. If you go back to that target, you see kind of where the hole was, but you see your patterns all around the head and neck area, which that's going to make a good clean harvest. Patterning and practicing, guys, is so important because you owe it to the turkey. You owe it to them while you're out there hunting. You don't want to take a really bad shot and wound a turkey. A wounded turkey is not a fun thing to try to track down and find. They can get hit, and of course, you owe it to that animal to harvest him quickly and ethically. So that's why it's so important about patterning and shooting and finding the right shotgun that fits you, the right choke that fits that shotgun, and the right ammunition that goes with it. And that's going to help you be really, really successful as you get out there in the spring woods, patterning your shotguns. Well, guys, tonight we've talked about a lot of stuff. We've talked about your gear. Josh Huff says best choke for Stevens is 301 and a 410. Hey, Josh, you know, that may be true. I have yet to shoot the 410 with the TSS ammo that Federal has. And that may be so. Just look at your patterns, man. You know, shoot several loads through that and see how that thing, if it's holding a good pattern at, you know, 25 or 30 yards, you ought to be in the money there. Great question. Excuse me. Again, folks, you know, we've talked about a lot of stuff. We talked about gear and what to find. I hope this has kind of give you a little bit something to think about, a little to think about what I might need. You know, Norman and Devin gave some great information about where to go and find. We have the series on our video tonight about what's in your turkey vest. Doesn't mean you got to run out and buy every call, everything that goes in there. The main thing about vests and gear and cushions and seats and chairs, it's about being comfortable while you're in the woods, having the things you need while you're chasing turkeys. Because the longer you can stay out there, the more comfortable you can be, and it takes patience. If anything out there has gotten a lot of gobblers out there, it's being patient. And having the right equipment and the right gear will help you be patient, help you stay in the woods longer, and be more successful. Guys, really enjoyed our segment tonight. This has been really, really neat talking about gear. This is our second episode. We'll be looking forward to next week. And next week's segment, we'll be talking about preseason scouting and how to scout. Hey, if you're not an NWTF member, you need to join. Go visit NWTF.org and join as a member today. Join one of the best conservation groups that's out there. If you're looking to learn more about turkey hunting, go to Calcomy and our Turkey Hunting 101. There is a study course there that will walk you through the basics of turkey hunting. It's always important to learn more. Hey, to become a really good turkey hunter, I learned from my mistakes, but I always was looking for more information to make myself a better hunter while I was out there in the wood. Hey, guys, thank you for joining us this week. We'll look forward to seeing you again next Tuesday for another episode of Turkey Hunting Basics. Have a great evening.